Okay, I want to take just a stand back for a second, and I want to show you a little bit of where I learned the kind of things that we just did. Okay, now that you've got a little bit of a feel for it, you need to know where to go, you know, when you need a refresher, when you are not quite sure what to do, and those kind of things, okay? So what I did over the last month while I've been learning this thing, I basically put some links on a wiki that I run on a server at the university, okay? So I want to go take you to those links, and you can have that information to go back to. It's incredible the amount of information that's available on the internet. I have been absolutely amazed at how well it's worked just to Google things. In fact, I don't think there's been a time in the last month when I've Googled something about a question about Android or Java or any of this stuff that I don't know, and I don't know very much when it comes down to it, that I haven't found the answer. Somebody else asked the same question and they got the answer, and sometimes there are several answers and you can pick the one you like best, okay? There's often even discussions about those answers, okay? So I want to point you, first of all, to Google, because that's the place where I got all the information. And secondly, I'd like to point you to the web page that I put up the most significant and useful links, and we'll look just a little bit at those links, then we'll get back to the programming, okay? So let's do that first. Okay, the thing you need to remember is fweb.wallawalla.edu, okay? I think the person who put the made that name, they called it fweb because I'm Professor Frohne there, and so they called it fweb, and it's just been that ever since, okay? So if you go to fweb.wallawalla.edu, that's where you're going to find this wiki, and it's the class wiki is the one that I use, so if you click on that, and down here, it's Android programming. So if you click on that, and basically, these are the links that I put up every time I found something especially good that I really liked, I put up there. Now, first thing I'm going to show you here, I'm not sure about this site, how totally legal this site is, but this site has a tremendous amount of very, very good information. Actually, what it has is a whole ton of IT books, including a lot of them on Android and Android programming. And so if you look at this thing right here, here's just all these books, and you can download PDFs of all these books. Now, I'm not sure, like I said, whether this is truly legal or not, but, you know, if you want to do the same thing you do to go Barnes & Noble and look at those books and find out whether this is the one you want to buy before you go to Amazon, they're all there, all these books, and you know the whole thing is there in PDF. And actually, sometimes I've found it very handy to have the book right on my computer and read it on my computer, because then I can go and try out immediately in Eclipse or whatever that thing that I'm reading about, okay? So there's a whole ton of books there on this it.ebooks site. Okay, now,
back up to that original web URL so I can write it down.
Yeah, it-ebooks. Fweb. Oh, fweb. Oh, yeah, okay. It's just fweb.wallawalla.edu. Let me go back here. It's this first part, fweb.wallawalla.edu. If you just go there, and then you'll see the class wiki link and so on. Okay, so I put some links on Java here because, like I said, I had never really programmed in Java before, okay? So I needed to learn some things about Java. And this is one of those books up there. I put a link to the book. Sun, you know, who developed Java, they have some very, very nice tutorials. I guess it's Oracle now, but they have some very nice tutorials online, and those are right there. And then there was some stuff on Eclipse. I'd actually used Eclipse before, but you know, I have to say, I really didn't like Eclipse before. And I think the reason I didn't like it was because Eclipse is really made for Java, and I tried to use it for some C++ stuff and some other things, you know, some assembly language, and it wasn't really as well suited. I might like it now better for that I've got used to it with the Android development tools, but I didn't used to like it, but there are some references here which are very helpful for learning Eclipse. Now, the best thing for me that I found on the internet are these screencast tutorials. They're basically doing the same thing we're doing here live, but they do it on a screencast. And you can download it and watch it anytime you want. And they're usually short segments, shorter than the segments we've been doing here, okay? And these short segments usually have very good information about a small topic range. Some of them are done better than others, you know, it's the way it always is, but these tutorials for me are very helpful because I'm kind of a show me, and more of an audio learner than, you know, reading is not as easy for me. I like to see things, you know, diagrams and things like that. But these video tutorials are, for me, just absolutely wonderful, okay? And so these tutorials right here, all of them were very helpful for me, and I put notes about what was most helpful and so on there, and that's... That's something I highly recommend, these tutorials. And the internet is changing. There's a thing called the massive open online courseware. And it's a thing where you can take college classes for free on the internet. And just the other day, I noticed that there was a new, what they call these things are MOOCs. And there was a new MOOC in the UK, and this new MOOC, I went and looked at their website, and the top course they had there was Android programming, okay? And I put a note on here somewhere about that MOOC, yeah, right down here. So I think starting October 14, if you guys want to take a free college class, and I don't know, it was developing an Android game or something, there you go, okay? So life is changing. Learning is becoming much easier than it used to be. So these are some of the references that I've used, and hopefully they'll be of some use to you as well. Google is wonderful, and what people have put on the internet, thank you to all of you guys. I know a lot of you guys have put some stuff on the internet that I've already used myself. My thanks to you for that, because it's just wonderful. Okay, any questions before we go on back to the programming?
You mentioned you could program in Python or C++. If you do that, and if somebody then buys your or downloads your app from the App Store, will they get a cryptic message like Python isn't here or C++ isn't here? In other words, are these languages built into the I don't know. I'm thinking
they're not as well integrated into the App Store. So I don't know what happens with Python. I do know that if you do something with the NDK, I think that integrates into the App Store pretty well. But Python, at least on Android, is generally an app which you need to install. And I have seen some apps on the App Store that say, look, you need to install this first. So I know there's some of that happens. For example, I use an app called Octave all the time. It's a MATLAB clone. And I have Octave on my Android phone, which is absolutely, you know, incredible. I mean, it's a fantastic tool. But in order to run plots on Octave, I had to download a library that did the plots. And right there on the App Store thing, it said, you need to download this, and if you don't do that, it comes up with a little error message that says, look, you've got to do this. So it's not as well integrated. Java is very well integrated, and some of those others are not. There is something very nice that I discovered about Android. In any app you make, if you wish to, you can make your app respond to different URIs or be the thing that somebody else uses their app. Or you can make your app use somebody else's app. Like, for example, if you wanted to have an app that took a photo of something, okay, maybe you decided to make an SSTV app and you'd like to use the camera, right? Well, it's very easy to use the camera. You just set up what's known as an intent. An intent is a data structure that says, this is what I intend to do. This is what I want to do. And you can, in very short order, you can make an your app, it will just open the camera and be feeding data back to your app, the pictures, the video, or whatever, okay? It's incredibly easy. And likewise, if you're making the camera app, it's very easy to make it so that your app advertises itself as being able to give you video output, okay? Or whatever your app happens to do. And so every app you make on Android can be an extension to somebody else's app, or somebody else's app, if they made it so that you can use it that way, then you can use it as an extension as well. So it's a wonderful thing. You know, there's some very, very nice things. You're just extending the usefulness of the phone. And it's not just for you, it's for everybody. If you set it up that way, it's actually very easy to do that. And maybe I should point to one of these tutorials which shows you how to do that. This guy, Jonathan Engelsma, here, he has about 6 or 8 tutorials there. And his tutorials I really like. They were very high quality. He's a professor at a university somewhere, and he has made some tutorials where you can get information from those tutorials very quickly compared to some of the other ones. You know, the number of minutes you have to watch to get the number of bits of information, bits per minute is good, okay? And he has a thing on how to do those intents both ways. There's one video that shows you how to do it both ways. One that says, look, I want to make my application available to other applications to give them this data, or vice versa, the other way around. You know, I want to use the camera to get some data or whatever, okay? So that one right there is very useful for that. I highly recommend that link right there. Are there other questions before we go on? I mean, general questions about, you know, how this whole thing works might be, you know, quite appropriate now. I mean, there's some things I can say. You know, every Android app runs as its own user. So when you start two apps, there are actually two users on your system. Android is based on Linux. In Linux, there are different users, but usually a user is logged in and he has many, many different programs running under his user name. But on Android, every program is its kind of encased as its own user. That way it keeps some security going. One program can't mess with somebody else's another program's files. So that's what they do. So there are a lot of little things you learn as you kind of go along and read these books and read these, you know, tutorials and watch the videos. But, you know, I'm not very far ahead of you. 1 month about tops, okay? So, any other questions before we go back to the Eclipse IDE? And okay, here we go, back to Eclipse. Okay, so we just changed the heading button. Let's look at the XML for that. If you look at this little tab down here, see it says graphical layout right there. That's where we're at right now. But if I click this activity class XML, then you notice here I've got the XML here. And it's kind of hard to read that thing on this screen because I've got all those other windows open, right? Well, what you can do to make that easier is you double click on the name of the file, and now it's changed its perspective so that we're just looking at the editor, okay? If you want to get back, you just double click on that file name and we're back to where we were, okay? So I think right now we should look at this XML file just a little bit. This is the file that was generated by us dragging those objects over onto that layout. And the top thing is the layout. And the layout basically says, well, I'm going to have a whole series of different objects, you know, gadgets or widgets or whatever coming down the screen here. And right now I think it's using what's called a linear layout. There's a bunch of different kinds of layouts. You can look at that and change it the way you want it to be. You know, if you want it to, instead of go down the screen like I'm doing, you can have it go across the screen, and there's various different things. And also, we could actually look at that same layout and what happens if you rotate your phone, okay? But anyway, the top section of XML, that's from right up here, this thing right here, it says relative layout, and it has all this stuff in here. All these gadgets right here are those properties, some of them which we put in, some of them were the defaults. Most of them here were the defaults. You can notice that the class name got stuck in there, and there's various different things. You can kind of read that and guess approximately what it means, okay? But when you're having to guess approximately what it needs, sometimes that's not good enough. In that case, Google is your friend. You know, just copy and paste that thing into Google, and it will come back with some more explanation for whatever that is, okay? And, you know, if you're having a problem, you know, you want to make your layout so that it's looking a little different for some reason or other, Google is your friend again. You know, go to Google, and I've done this hundreds of times, and it generally tells you something about, you know, what you need to do. So the next thing here, this is the button layout right here. It tells you the ID here. That's the thing we changed, right? The name of the button. Wrap content. Basically, wrap content means that, you know, make it about the right width. You know, if it has to, make it wrap around to the next line. And align parent top true, that basically, you know, it says align the top with the parent. And it tells you what the text string was down here. You know, this is a string and the heading string, and the actually value of that was heading. That was in the strings file. And then you've got the text view here. We really didn't do anything much on the text view. It's giving me a little yellow line underneath that text view. You see that yellow line there? That means there's a warning here. And it says here, hard coding text view should use a string resource, okay? So what it's saying is, look, right now it says text view in that text view, right? We really don't want it to say text view in there, actually, do we? And so it's saying, well, you have a hard-coded string in there. In other words, you're not using one of those strings in the strings file, that one like we did up here. Notice we used a string here. That's something that could be internationalized easily. This cannot be internationalized easily, okay? So we probably want to change that. And so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to delete this here. I'm going to put in nothing, a blank string. It still gives me the grief here. I could put in a blank string, an actual string, but in basically any language I can imagine, a blank string is a blank string, so I'm not going to worry about it, okay? Okay, so then we go down here to the edit text. Okay, now this edit text is similar to what we had before. Notice it's aligning left with the heading button and aligning the right edge with the heading button, so it's basically the same size as the heading button. And it has the top margin is 23 dots down. It's using font size 10 here. And its type was a number, okay? So that means we can only enter a number in there, and that's kind of what we wanted. So that's what the layout file looks like. Now, there's a couple things I'd like to fix, or one thing at least I can think of I'd like to fix. On that text file, the edit text thing right here, I don't like that cursor being on the left. Everything else is centered on that thing. It just bugs me. So I want that in the center, right? So what I can do is I can click on that guy right there. I'm clicking on that to select it. And then there's either you can go down here and you can change the gravity, or you can go up here and change the gravity, this thing right here. Generally on any of the stuff in Eclipse, if you leave your mouse there for a little while, it will tell you what that button is, okay? So it says this is change the gravity, and I want to change the gravity on that thing so that that's going to make it, I want to make it center horizontal. And now I'm going to save this. Didn't look like it worked. Let's see what it did down in the thing here. Did it enter that? Edit text.
Did it for text view.
Oh, I did the wrong one. Okay, thank you. Yeah, abort. Well, so we'll go down to, is that the text view? This isn't. Edit text. So we'll just copy this guy right here. No, I don't want center layout. I want gravity. Well, we'll show you how it works if you just enter it in here. See how this works. Oops. Okay, I just typed Android in the colon there, and now it popped up with a whole bunch of help for me, okay? These are all the things that could go in there, right? So I wanted something called gravity, or I wanted, let's see, Android gravity. Yeah, Android gravity, that's what I want. And I want to say equals, and I want to do, what do I want to do? Center? Horizontal center? Center horizontal. Okay, so let's see what happens if we save this guy and then go look at it. No. Okay, time to look at my notes.
It underlined it.
Oh, it's underlined it. Probably not the right value. Still helps to look at my notes. I know it's in here. Ah, gravity is not a valid value. Okay, so gravity is wrong somehow here. Okay.
That's bad English. Center horizontal and attribute gravity is not a valid.
And they're not the same to valid together. Okay. I want, let's see, center underscore horizontal, I think it says here. Okay, so let's try that. Back to this. Yeah, see, there's an error. Anytime there's an error there, it'll tell you. The red line means an error. So let's try this. Horizontal like that. No?
Underscore.
Underscore. Is there an underscore there?
Underscore lowercase h, yeah.
No?
Well, I think it's that you need an equal true on the end of it.
You're trying to set gravity to a string.
Yeah, I'm trying to set gravity to a string. Maybe I don't want a string at all. You're right. Well, no. Let's see here.
Oh, you left layout.
Yeah,
oh,
no, that's layout.
Android.layout,
not gravity.
No, it says Android. Here says Android.gravity equals, and then quotes center underscore horizontal. Okay, well, I'm going to say at this point, doesn't matter. Let's get rid of that. I'll live with it for now. One of those things. Not quite sure, because I had the same thing I had on my other one here, and there was no error on this one. So that's a mystery to be solved at a later date. So anyway, that's, you know, there are things. I could also go over here and look on the, we're on the text, edit text one. We should change that name. Let's change that name to, this was going to be our, we're going to put our heading in there. So I'm going to say bearing edit text. I'm going to call that bearing edit text for the name, and then it changed that everywhere.
I'm sorry, where are you?
Right here. I double-clicked on this little, the ID over here. Let me see if I can bring this over and you can see it a little better. I double-clicked on this little guy right here. On my screen, it's three buttons. On some people's screen, it's just one button. And I just double-clicked on that. And then I typed in bearing edit text instead of edit text one. Is that okay? Okay, and we need to, somewhere here, I did have a text view, didn't I? Yeah, here it is. Okay, there it is, text view. I want to change that from text view one as well. I want to change that to something else.
Whoa, too fast.
Too fast? Do it again?
No, I'm still on the edit text one.
Okay, so you go, you highlight the edit text, which was edit text one for you. And then there's the top line is ID. And you click this button right here. And then you type in bearing edit text. Is that okay?
Am I supposed to leave the little thing, the plus ID thing at the beginning?
I think it, you could enter it right over here like this and leave the plus, at sign plus ID on it right there. You could just do it there too. Okay, so are we ready to go for the next one here? Okay, so we're going to go change this text view one. We're going to change this to, just like we just did. On the ID text view one, you could change it right here. You know, I could just go like this, back up over this, and I could say, well, what do I want to call this? I want to call this the heading text view. It's hard to read for me over here looking at kind of an angle. Yeah, that's true. Then I have to put my glasses on. So I'm stuck. I think it's okay. Looks like it's spelled all right. Okay?
Yeah, V-E-I-W.
Yeah, oops, cancel. Oops. I got to do it again here. Edit text view. So this was heading text V-I-E-W. Good, got it. And now it says, do we want to update references? I'm going to say yes. And I'm going to say OK. And then it updates the references, OK? You could also just double click on this little double button here, and then you don't have to do the, you can do it all in the box. Everybody caught up there? OK, good. So let's see. Do you guys see anything else that's generic here we probably need to worry about? I think we're probably OK. Okay? So the next thing we need to do is actually go hook this code that is in, let's go back to this layout here. We need to hook the code that we just generated over here in the layout. We need to hook that into our Java program, okay? And the code that was generated is up here in this gen file right here in r.java, and you can go looking at that. There's a whole ton of stuff there, okay? And what we need to do is go up here to the source. We need to edit our source. This is where we put our stuff, okay? We never really need to fiddle with the gen stuff. That's the stuff they automatically generated. It gets regenerated every time we do a clean. And sometimes you actually need to regenerate that stuff. I've had some instances where I was playing around in the GUI on the layout, and I got things messed up pretty badly. And I was getting errors when I would run the program. I didn't see any errors in Eclipse, but when I'd run it, there would be a crash, and it was thinking the edit text was a button somehow. It was cast as a button. Because of the way I'd move things around, it somehow got the edit text, thought it was the button in the generated code. And there's a thing you can do if you go up to your menu here, go up to project, and it says clean here. So if you just clean that regenerates the generated code in Java. And that's something that I found out was quite handy to know about, because you can pull your hair out for a while trying to figure out what in the world is going on, because it's actually nothing, no problem you did. Something happened in the generated stuff. Somehow you caused it to do that. And it's very hard to know what you did. But the cleanup, regenerating that code, solves the issue. And of course, I found that out on Google, right? So anyway, what we need to do here is we need to look at not the generated stuff. So I'm gonna kind of close that, because it's taking up room, and I'm gonna close these guys down here. We're not gonna worry about the icons anymore. Well, maybe I'll leave the activity layout there, because we might mess with that later. So here's our Java class right here. This is what was generated for us. Remember, we typed in rotor class. We called it that instead of main activity, right? So this is our Java class. And this is where we're going to start working on our code here. We've got another, 150 lines of code to write here or something to make this thing all work. So this is what it made for us. And first of all, the package, that's the thing that I typed in, the EDU. You put in your URL in reverse order here. And that's the thing that identifies this program uniquely to Google and anyone else who's doing this stuff. There's a bunch of imports in here. These imports, basically what it's doing is it's taking and importing the data it needs to know about various things, like this OS bundle. It imported that. It needed that. And notice when I just put my mouse over that OS bundle, it pops up with something very, very helpful, okay? It tells you what that thing is, okay? So, you know, in the old days, I used to have a book, and I would have to go read that book, you know, to find out what this thing was, right? Well, now, all I have to do is put my mouse cursor over the thing, whatever it is, and the docs pop up here. And, you know, see these little blue things? These are hyperlinks. And if I click on that, it will open up a window, you know, like I could click on this, and it's opening up a window in the Android docs that tells about that whole business, okay? Whatever it was.
It's not doing that here.
Oh, it's not doing that.
And I only have one import line, not three like you do. Yeah, click on the plus sign.
You got to click on the yeah. I got if I there's a plus sign there.
Oh, got it. Now I have three. Okay.
Okay. And you just put your mouse over bundle and just leave it there, and nothing pops up.
And nothing pops up.
I just got an error said the attached Java doc could not be retrieved.
Oh, interesting.
Windows, you got to double click on it. You know, don't put it over, you don't.
If you double click on it,
yeah.
Like that?
I was able to just leave it there for a while, and it eventually did come up. but
then you didn't find it because it didn't have the something installed, right? Or
And in Mac, you just got to wait it out.
You got to wait it out. Yeah, well, my apologies. I should have tried this in Windows and Mac to see what would happen. You know, I watched so many video tutorials, everybody doing it on Windows, right? So I just thought, oh, Windows just works.
Windows never works.
But I'm sure if you do a little Googling, you can find out why it's not working, okay? I would say, yeah, maybe. What would we type into Google here to get this, to figure out what this is? There is a way you can set this thing up over here in properties. I think it's if you go to Window Preferences, and Editors. I'm trying to remember here. Annotations, maybe? Hyperlinking. It may be something in here where you would actually set it up. I went to Windows, and down at the very bottom of the Windows menu was Preferences. I opened that, and then I went in under here, under the Editor part, which is under the General. And as you can see, there are just tons of options here. And being a novice, I don't know, you know, exactly what each one of them does, but I think it's somewhere down in here. You could turn off some of those kind of things, okay? Or turn them on. Mine, of course, it says enable, but I'm not sure why yours didn't come that way. That's rather disgusting. But like I said, I think if you Google hovering or docs not showing up or something like that, you could probably find some answers there.
Question?
Yes.
Java doc on Linux is not standard. By default, is not installed standard. At least on a lot of distributions.
Right, yeah.
So you have to install Java doc in order for this.
So on Linux, I did have to install some. It was probably installed. You know, I just went and installed everything. You know, and it's sometimes on Linux, it's hard to know when you previously installed something, it just works. You know, and if you haven't, it doesn't. So yeah, so you need to install the docs.
And then restart Eclipse.
Probably. But I found this very helpful, okay? So anyway, here's what you can do, okay? You can go out to Google. Suppose you wanted to do this. This is what I did, okay? I knew what I needed to do. I need to make a socket program, and I need to have this socket program input and output data, right? That's what I need to do. That's basically what I'm trying to do. Just send a P and, you know, and get some data back, right? That's all I need to do. So I just went out on Google and I looked for network or socket tutorial, right? And I found a bunch of them on there, and most of them were one direction, unidirectional. So I found one finally that was bidirectional. And I really looked at the code and it looked just like that. Probably looks to you, it looked like Greek, right? I wasn't really quite sure what it was doing. But I said, oh, well, shoot, I'll try this. And I copied and pasted into my editor, okay? And then I discovered you could do this kind of stuff, right? And all of a sudden, you can look at somebody's code and there's built-in help. It's like, you know, the guy didn't comment everything, but it doesn't matter so much because you just hover over the thing and it tells you all about it. Which is incredible. I mean, it's like, oh, thank you, Lord. I like that. So anyway, that's what I did. And you can look at some of these things. You know, here's our public class rotor, okay? This is basically the thing that tells how to build a rotor class. And there's some things down here. This thing, @override. Override means that inside this class which rotor was extended or built upon. See, rotor class it starts with a thing called activity. It's an activity, but our rotor class is going to, it's going to subclass that rotor class, I mean that activity class. It's actually based on that activity class, and this override means that function that we're looking at right down here, this onCreate, is I'm doing my own stuff in onCreate, and then down here I call their onCreate, okay? Super means the activity class, the thing above what I did. Looks like there's a question here.
Yeah, I have a question about backup on package.
Yeah.
Where you've got edu.wallawalla.kl7na and then your package name. Mm-hmm. What's going to happen when we all start using that as our package definition? Is that...
Well, you know, if you actually put this up on the App Store, it might be a problem, you know. You should put in your own thing, but, you know, I put in that because that's where I'm from. But you could use...
What if we don't have our own thing yet to...
Just use com.example or whatever, you know, or you can use that. I think the thing that would happen is if you actually, you know, built this app and then actually put it on the App Store... Then there would be some kind of, you know, it would think it was the same app. If I put the same thing on there, or if two of us did, then it would think it was the same app. It's basically an identifier for our stuff. All the stuff in that's not in the package EDU Walla Walla KL7NA seminar rotor, that's the stuff in here isn't available to people who don't have that package. They would need to import that package to have this stuff in their code. So, I'm not sure exactly what would happen, but there's something like that, you know. It's not I don't think it'll be a problem for any of us, though, because I've seen plenty of people using the com.example thing that comes up normally, and I'm sure there's lots of people who have probably tried to check something in with that before they knew what they were doing, and, you know, some interesting things probably happened. So anyway, back to this. There's another override here on create menu options or options menu. I'm actually not going to use the options menu here in our tutorial, but that's something you can add later. I at the end, I have a couple of little homework or challenges for you to do that you can go out on your own and try to add to this program, okay? So I'm not going to get rid of that thing. That was already put in for us. That basically makes the little menu for us. So, but I am going to have to modify this onCreate thing here. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to kind of start right in here. And the first thing we're going to do is we're going to put in some fields. Okay, these fields are like, these are going to be variables. They're going to be global variables inside this class, this rotor class. And they'll be available from all the places inside this class. And so the reason I can say that is because they're just inside these, that guy right there and that guy right there. Those two guys are the enclosing braces. So if I put something inside those enclosing braces, it's available to all the stuff inside those enclosing braces, but not available to stuff outside unless I call it public. There are several other things. See, this is public right here. There's protected, and then there's private, okay? So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna make three things. We need to make three things. We just made three things. One of them was our edit text, one of them was our text view, and the other one was our button, right? And we've gotta get those things connected to our code right here. Because I don't see anything in here that says anything about those buttons that we made, right? So first thing I need to do is declare a button. So, whoops, I don't need capitals here. Button, and what did I call that button? I called it heading button. Is that it? Now, notice there's an underline there on that heading button, and if I put my mouse over that underline means there's an error, right? So somehow this thing doesn't know about buttons, and those, this is what we call quick correct. So it basically comes up with a list of things that will fix this error for me. So being a Joe dummy, I'm very grateful for that gadget, okay? It's incredible. Don't you wish every time you had an error in a program, it popped up with something like this and say, hey, dummy, here's how you fix this. And that's what you do. So basically, in our case, in this case, the top one says import, I think. And we need to import the button stuff. So I'll just click on that. And now up here, notice it says Android widget button imported. And that red line went away, right? Whoa, isn't that cool? I like it. OK, so next. Let's see, we had what was a button, and then there was a text view. So I'm going to call a text view. Now this thing in front, this button, basically tells the program that heading button is an object of type button, okay? And that what I'm typing in down here, text view, I'm going to type, what do we call it, heading text view. And it's got the same problem with text view, right? So I'm going to go down here to quick correct and import text view, and that's fixed, okay? And then the last thing was an edit text. Oops, EDIT. And this was the bearing. Probably something like that. And it doesn't know what edit text is, so we'll import that. Okay. So we declared three global variables inside this thing. I could put private in front of this button if you wanted. I think. Whoops.
So I got stuck and I'm calling Bill
Hunter. Okay, let's go a little slower here.
I moused over on a button, which is, sorry for
button. Oh yeah, and your quick correct isn't working, or it is?
It says button cannot be resolved to a type 6, quick fix is available.
And pick the top one, import the
button Android widget.
Right.
And as soon as I move my mouse down to do that, the pop-up disappears.
I maybe try F2 and it will keep it from disappearing. At least on my screen it says that. Like if I
try F2. And it does highlight that little window.
And it does. Okay, now can you mouse down to that thing?
It's still, as soon as I move the mouse, it disappears.
Interesting. You're running on Linux too?
Yep. Press F2 for focus. I press F2. And it does turn it into a window that looks a lot more solid. It's about
right, yeah, right.
Oh, the up arrow down arrow keys got worse.
Oh, well. Yeah, I don't know. What can I say?
I got it using a
different. Yeah, right. Well, thanks for the help there. That's good.
So.
Okay, well, something here, there's a little yellow line under this, and it says something here. What does this say?
I don't have that yellow line.
I said heading button.
Yeah,
When you put private in there, that's when it showed
up. Oh, yeah, that's when it showed up. Okay, yeah, right, okay. I don't know. I think we'll just leave private out. But private basically means that it's only available to stuff in this program. I don't know what the default is in Java. Maybe some of you guys can tell me. What is the default if you don't put private? Is it?
I think it's private.
It's private. Huh. Wonder why it changed. It gave me a little warning there.
It said it wasn't used.
Yeah. Oh, it wasn't used. Well, yeah, we haven't got there yet. So, so okay, it wasn't used. So we need to actually use it, and so we've got those three things there. That's basically, I think maybe we'll need, we might need a network task, another class here. But down here, let's go into this onCreate bundle. This onCreate thing here, you can read about it right there if you hover over it. It's basically the thing that is executed when you start this program, okay? When you create the thing. And when we create the thing, we want to associate those buttons and those text views and those edit boxes or whatever other widgets you've got. You want to associate them with the actual XML and the stuff that's in the gen folder there. So we need to get to look up these things here. So what I'm going to do down here is put right underneath this set content view, r.layout.activity_rotor class. I'm going to put in some things for those buttons that will find them in that other Java program in the r.java. So what we want to do is I want to say heading button, and then I'm going to put a dot here. And when you put a dot, basically that means you're going to call a method that's built into the heading button class or the heading button object, okay? Buttons can do things, and these are some of the things you can do. And so what I want to do is I want to, and it's giving me a whole list of them, a gob more than I want to sort through. So if you keep typing, set on, let's see, I want to set on clicked. Set on click listener, that's what I want. Set on click listener right there, okay? Whoops, okay, there it is. So I want to set the on click listener. No, I don't want to set the on click listener yet. I need to get by ID, I need to tell it. I haven't yet got that. Let's go back in heading button. I don't want to set the on click listener. I want to get the ID of this thing. So what is it? It's get or find. It's find ID. Whoops. If I could type, I'd be dangerous. Okay, what is it? It'll, yeah, I'm backing up. I want find view by ID. A view basically is any one of these widgets. So find view, whoops, no, back up. V-I-E-W by, I do, you think so? Well, I don't know, we'll find out.
There is a find view by ID.
Yeah, that's what we want, find view by ID. And then I want R dot, okay, R dot ID. Dot, and which one do we want? This is the button, right? So, heading button, right? Okay.
Did you have to insert the capital R there?
Yeah, I did do the R and then I did dot. Basically, R, all those, there was a file we looked in the gen folder that was r.java.something, and so this is actually in that file that we're actually associating this with. And you have to put a semicolon at the end of every statement in Java. So I stuck one on there. So this statement basically is going to go find and associate that button. This heading button is now going to be the one that we talked about, we made in our layout.
So my capital R has a red line under it. Yeah,
it probably will. Keep going and keep typing the ID and whatever, and it should
I've gotten all the way to the semicolon, and still, and now my capital R in the previous line has a red line under it.
Let's see, what are, maybe we're missing an import or something?
What does capital R represent?
Well, let me go show you that. Okay, so in the gen here, here it is, r.java. So if we look at this, r.java, here's class R, okay? So for some reason, your class R is not being, is not in the same package or something, I don't know.
It isn't built on his machine.
Did I miss a build it step?
Go up under project and clean. If you go project, clean, it should build it. I'm hoping anyway. On mine, it just kind of happens. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. I'm going to have to start thanking the Lord for a lot of stuff that didn't happen to me that happened to you guys. Oh, yeah, there's probably a lot happened to me that hasn't happened to you, too. That's true. But anyway, so this is the r.java file, and it's got all this stuff, basically, that was generated from that XML. So I want to close that because I'm not going to edit any of that. In the meanwhile, let me put in two more of these guys that should be similar here. Heading text view. Dot. Okay, I want to find view. Okay, heading text view. Wait a minute, I thought I changed the name of that. Maybe I didn't save. Okay, let's go back and find out what I didn't do. Yeah, I'm not saved. Let's go back here. See if that solved it. Okay, I'm gonna erase the dot. If you need it to give you the thing again, you have to erase the dot and type it again. Heading text view, there we go, thank you, you were very right. Oops, I need a semicolon here. Oh, good guess.
What is find view by ID doing?
Basically, find view by ID is it's going to find that text view or the button or whatever the widget was that you put in the XML, and it's associating that with our what we call our heading button or our heading text view or our bearing edit button or bearing edit text. It's associating. It's saying basically that's the same guy. Okay. So it's going to that other Java code, and it looks in that and associates that other Java code in the R class with our heading text view, okay? So we have a nice handle for it. Heading text view is much more readable than what they would have over in the R.java class. So I need the bearing edit text here. Dot, and then find, whoops. And this is the, where to go here, bearing edit text up on the top. Okay. So now with those three statements, now our Java code knows what those buttons are, okay? Now, when you have a button or an edit text, you need to be able to interact when the button is clicked or when the edit text is activated, okay? So let's go on and do that. And that we can do that in the same on-click listener. We can associate what's going to happen when we click the button and what's going to happen when we do the edit text. The text view, we really don't care because it's just going to output. Nothing from there is going to come back to us, so we don't really have to do anything there, okay? But the button, we need to tell what happens when the button is clicked. And the edit text, we need to tell what happens when the edit text is clicked. And so that's what I started to type by mistake here, but let's try it here. Heading button. Oops, I did it again. heading button, dot. And then what I want to do is set on-click listener. Yeah, set on-click listener. Okay, so the on-click listener, it's a listener. It's going to listen for when that button gets clicked. And when that button gets clicked, it's got to do something, right? So I need to have an on-click listener here. And if I remember right here, what I want to do now is I want to put a view. Remember I said a view was any of those things, you know, like the layout or the widget or whatever. View, and I want view.onClickListener. So basically, and I want to make a new view.onClickListener. So I'm going to type in here view.onClickListener. Okay, let's try this again here. It's got a syntax error here. Did I type it right? View.onClickListener. I guess I need a I needed that at the end, not there. OnClickListener is a function, so we need a parentheses. And now it's going to tell me here, cannot instantiate the view.onClickListener. Is there a space? There should be a space after new.
Semicolon at the end?
Yeah, that's what the last little bit there is. There, let me type that. Sometimes when you type the whole thing again, I didn't type the new right away, which was a problem. New view dot on click listener. So if I click that, there. Oh, interesting. Did you notice it popped up this stuff down here? Because I typed the new later, it didn't understand what I was doing. I should have put the new first. Basically, what that new is, it's creating a new object. The object is a view, and the object is an on-click listener. And if you notice, this is all this stuff is still within the parentheses. See this parentheses right there? This is all inside the argument of this set on-click listener thing, okay? So inside that, you know, the argument, it's like calculating a whole bunch of stuff before it sends it to this on-click listener. And this override right here is inside that argument, on-click listener argument. You can see the last parentheses for the on-click listener is right here. If you highlight one of the parentheses on something, the other one gets boxed in like this. So you can see what matches. So this is all stuff that's inside this argument, and basically it's putting a whole function in here, an on-click view, okay? So basically what's happening is we made an on-click listener, and in this on-click view here, it says to do auto-generated method stub. So we need to put some code in here. We need to tell it what to do if there's, you know, this button is clicked. And, you know, basically all I want to do is I want to go get the heading. Now, I'm just going to type a function in here, get heading. And, you know, there is no function get heading yet, right? I haven't written it. And it's got an error here. It probably says there's no function there. Let's see what it says. Okay. So yeah, there's no problem. And it says there's a quick fix. And the first one is create method getHeading or create method getHeading in type rota class. So there's two places we could put the getHeading. We could put it right underneath that override, that right inside the argument, right there. I should get out that pointer again. We could put it right there, or we could put it in the rotor class. That would be kind of outside, up, up like in this area, okay? Now, the difference between putting it in those two places, the difference is this. If I want to, in somewhere else in my program, if I want to get heading, I don't want to put the get heading inside here because it will only be useful inside this on-click listener thing here. I'm probably going to want to get heading maybe somewhere else in my code as well. So I want to put it out here. I want to put it in the more general area outside there. So I'm going to click on the second one down. One thing I've noticed is that in general, the first option on the quick fix is usually the most likely one. They've thought about this, okay? But that was the second one. So sometimes, you know, the second one is the one you want. Okay, so now notice down here it generated this thing and it says, we got some more code to generate, right? So we got to basically tell it how to get the heading. But at least it's going to do something. Now there was one other gadget we needed to set up with a listener, and that was the edit text, right? So maybe what we should do is take a little break here. We went a little longer this time, and then we'll put the edit text in there. Say again?
You need a semicolon.
Oh, yeah, right here on the, yep, you're right. Whoops, if I could type, I'd be dangerous. There we are. So you want to take a 5-minute break and stretch, bathroom break?